All right, wonderful. So we're going to get started. Welcome to the very last session of four sessions in this webinar series, Themes for Contemporary Art. You can see on the screen that our very last session will be around the theme of installation and is going to be taught by our fantastic educator, Kevin Miller, who is an artist and art educator who offers programs at a variety of museums around New York and has been part of the Guggenheim education program since 2008. Our theme for today will explore how artists create close encounters through spatial intervention in site-specific installations. Before we get started, I'm just gonna go over a few Zoom housekeeping tips. So you'll notice that the chat feature and the Q&A feature have been enabled at the bottom of your Zoom screen. If you'd like your comments to be shared with all of those in attendance, please change your chat settings in the drop-down menu to read all panelists and attendees. But if you'd like to keep your comments private and just have myself and Kevin read them, you can change your chat settings to just all panelists. For the Q&A feature, we'd love to use that if you would like to submit any artwork-specific or artist-specific questions. And Kevin and I will review those at the end and hopefully we'll do our best to answer all the questions you might have. Lastly, we'll be recording this webinar and sending the link to the recording out via email. So if you miss something, you can watch that later on at your leisure. All right, I'm going to hand it over now to Kevin to take it away.
Wow, thank you, Quina. Hello, everyone. Welcome. So glad we could all come together here today. It's just my pleasure. I'm delighted to be here to be able to share some information about some of the four of the artists in our collection. I just want to mention to you that for the interest of my keeping on track for our time frame today, I'm going to be referring to some notes as I go through the process today. I'm also going to be using some quotations by some of the artists that that I think are pertinent. And so I want to make sure that I get those properly read out to you. So if it's okay with you, I'm going to kind of be referring to some notes, as I mentioned. But I also, we have that chat feature set up. So, as Quina suggested, there will be times that come along that we have prompts, and I'm going to ask you to please feel comfortable to please participate and add comments into the chat as we work on to certain specific artworks, and I'll mention that when we get along there, and maybe Quina will be able to read some of those comments out as we work through the program today. So honored to be with you today. I'm going to go ahead and just change our slide here a little bit to talk about installation in contemporary art. And I've sort of given this a subtitle of spatial interventions. We're going to look at several artists from our collection spanning three generations and nearly 90 years of art making. So each of these artists has a unique physical and philosophical approach to their work, but they all share this common desire to activate that intangible element that we call space. So their idea is to engage the viewer with a direct physical experience. So as a result, we become active participants in the art making process. It's our participation that actually completes the work. These artists all share a desire to engage the viewer in a physical way and to interpret our preconceived notions about and our awareness about space, the space around us. So hopefully we can kind of discover some of the common threads and some of the differences between these artists and the things that set them apart from one another. Let's see here. A little technical glitch here. Let's just I'm going to move back here. A little technical problem, but we're going to move ahead. So space. We're talking a little bit about space today, and we could argue that looking at any artwork creates a relationship between the viewer and the object. And I know that's true for myself as I study artwork or look at a painting or a piece of art very intently. You know, there's some ways to sort of a passive exercise. I mean, it's sort of taking place in my eye and in my mind, rather than a holistic approach to the art making process. So while the work of artist Li Ufan, for example, relies heavily on our ability to open our minds and activate our minds and our imaginations, he's also very insistent on this idea of empty space as an element equal to, or if not more important than the actual objects contained within it. So he encouraged us to think in the whole, the idea that the space, the viewer, and the objects all share equal responsibility in the art making process. These artists are asking us to engage physically with their work, but today we're at a bit of a disadvantage because we're of the format that we're placed in today. So I'm hoping that you'll be able to just kind of play along with me a little bit. I'm going to ask you, just in the spirit of the artist's motivation, because what we're doing today is a little antithetical to what they might propose. So I'm going to ask you if you could just do me a favor and maybe take your eyes away from the screen at the moment. And if you're in a chair, perhaps you want to push back a little bit, or feel free to stand take in the view of the space that's around you. I'd like you to just kind of think about the awareness of the objects, maybe the closest object, that object that's closest to you, or one that might be further away. And just let your eyes sort of wander over the area where you're currently stationed. I'd like you to think about a little bit about, is there light coming into the room? And if there's light coming into the room, what is that light like? Is it a sharp light? Is it a soft, diffused light? Is there a color to the light? Does it tend to be maybe warm and a bit golden or yellow? Or is that light perhaps blue and a little bit cooler? Is that light coming in from a natural source, or is it coming from a light or some sort of artificial source of light? I'd like it also to consider maybe how far away is that next piece of furniture? What is that object? So just taking a moment to kind of closely examine the environment that we're currently in might help us gain a feeling for what these artists are trying to offer to us. Sorry, folks, I just a little bit of an issue with the screen here, so we'll move forward. The first artist that I would like to talk about, and this is an artist who worked in the early to the middle of the 20th century, is the artist David Smith. And David Smith was born in 1908 in Indiana. And after high school, he worked a summer job as a welder and a riveter at a Studebaker automobile factory. And then around 1926, when he's about 20 years old, he moves to New York City and begins studying art in earnest. He later purchased a property in upstate New York and then later relocated there. And that's where we can see him positioned in this photograph. I'm going to move ahead to another work here. This is the artist with his work Australia, which is part of the Museum of Modern Art collection, a rather large sculpture. His work often contained figurative elements or some sort of abstracted figurative elements. And he used drawings often too to kind of conceptualize some of his sculpture. I'm going to move ahead to an installation that the artist created on his space. So here we have this landscape that the artist is using. And on the photo on the left is actually a photograph taken by the artist. So we can even see that he's thinking not only sculpturally and as far as objects in space, but also photographically. So the way that he's composed this image for us. by seeing, you know, these rather tall totems in the foreground, and then kind of moving across the space or moving across the landscape. And we can imagine that these tall elements kind of merge with what we can see, maybe the outline of a forest or some stand of trees along that back edge of the horizon there. If we move over to the photo on our right, we can see also the artist here has set up just a large stand of sculptures in a very linear fashion. I think of this almost like a cornrow or something that relates a little bit more to farm life, the way that these are positioned. But we could imagine, you know, trying to meander our way through this space, kind of work our way around some of these sculptures. And taking them in. And then, of course, as we turn, you know, we encounter something different and something different. So the artist had this feeling that, you know, being immersed in his sculpture, of having more than one element around, would certainly heighten our experience of the work and maybe our understanding of the work as well. I'm going to move to another slide here. Here's another image that the artist created. So here, using natural element, which comes and goes, of course, in the landscape, in this case, fog. So we have a large stand of multicolor objects here, all positioned relating to one another, and also interacting somehow. And in this particular photograph, we could see it interacting with that element, the fog, that sort of blanket that might encompass all of us. So we can imagine sort of walking through this atmosphere and what it might be like to encounter these objects. However, even though Smith is really thinking a little bit about space, we can still see that these are somewhat static objects. I mean, we do have these pedestals, and they're vertical objects placed on a pedestal. So it's sort of up to us to kind of meander through, but there's not as much interaction that we could have with these works. But we do have to respect the fact that the artist is thinking about space and how he's using it. I'm going to show you a drawing that the artist created. And this is one of the works that he did. Smith had a very high regard for drawing, and he viewed it as the most primal of human expressions. But he'd also use it as a tool in some ways to conceptualize about artwork and leaping onto the three-dimensional object. Smith considered his sculptures to be drawings in space. And so I'm going to move here to a sculpture that the artist has created. This is from 1950. And maybe we can take a look at a side-by-side here, see these two works in tandem. And I'll leave it up to you to kind of determine whether you feel that this concept is fulfilled or not, this idea of sculpture being a drawing in space. If we have time permitting later, I'll try to circle back to this, and maybe we can discuss this again at the end. So while Smith is working and preparing for his first New York exhibition, the artist and philosopher Li Ufan is born in Korea in 1936. And here's an image of the artist in one of his large installations in a park. So at the age of 20, Li Ufan moved to Japan, where he studied Eastern and Western philosophy. And in the late 1960s, he became associated really as a leading practitioner of a movement of art in Japan known as Monoha. And the Monoha, loosely translated, means school of things or school of objects. Monoha has its focus that objects have an innate physical properties. And they sort of turning away from the technology of the time and man-made objects and using materials in their own natural state with as, you know, little intervention as possible. Li stated that he is interested in perceptions that arise from a relationship of encounter rather than the existence of images or objects. So as he states, encounters with the unknown. So trying to lead us into a sense of mystery and exploration, again, using our imaginations to move forward with that. In 2011, the museum, the Guggenheim Museum in New York, presented Li Ufan, Marking Infinity, and it was the first major North American retrospective of the artist's work. And that was organized by senior curator of Asian art, Alexandra Monroe, and I'd just like to give a shout out to her groundbreaking work. Let's go ahead and we're gonna explore a few images from the exhibition. Here we can see an installation. This is our Frank Lloyd Wright Museum. We're at the top of our rotunda here, as close as we can be to our the beautiful oculus that dominates the space in Frank Lloyd Wright's circular building. And we have the artists here responding, of course, to the architecture and the placement of this work. With the placement of the work. So Li insists that the space dictate how that final work will present itself. So I think it's a really kind of interesting comment that he sort of removes himself from the process and talking about how the objects, the space, will all dictate the way that these works are presented. I'm going to jump to another image now. This is a work called Relatum, originally from 1971, and then recreated in our museum in 2011. This work had been reinstalled many times, but always in new configurations. So these works are all site-specific, or what is considered site-specific, meaning that the location, again, dictates that overall appearance of the work, so as I just said before. So while the concepts can be carried forward, each unique location adds a different element to the work. So I'd like to see if we can just take a moment to kind of closely look at this work. The artist here using essentially two elements, a natural material, stone, and a man-made element. In this case, we have these small cushions. And although they're man-made, I suspect that these are made probably from natural materials. We might have an element like cotton here, or some kind of a feather or natural material kind of filling that cushion. So I'm hoping maybe you can play along with us, because, you know, obviously we're at a little bit of a deficit here in terms of being able to be in the space. So I wonder if you could try, and maybe we could do a walk through this space together and imagine with me what it might feel like to wander through this gallery. So the light is low, the temperature feels cool. We might have an uneasy sensation perhaps of, you know, standing tall amongst all these seated objects. Lower to the floor. Perhaps we have a desire to reach out and touch one of these objects. And maybe we could focus our attention here to this stone in the front, in the foreground here. You know, what that feels like, we can call it memories of what that might feel like to run our hands over the smooth surface of a stone and feel the crevices and the angles that offers. In a space like this, you know, of course, each time we turn around, there's a slightly different encounter, a new relationship is created. So I'm going to approach our first activity, or our first series of comments. I'm going to request, and Quina, this is just a nod to you, if we can activate our chat. I'm really curious about this idea of the two elements that the artist is using, and he will use that throughout his work, and we're going to look at some other works too, where essentially he's pairing two objects within a space, so that'd be the third object, the fourth object, of course, being the viewer or the participant. But in this case, the elements the artist is pulling together are two objects, so we have stones and we have cushions. So, you know, I kind of wonder if that's just a sign of respect to these stones that the artist has selected to place in the gallery. But I'm going to ask you to maybe enter your thoughts, just some brief comments about what connections you might be able to make about the artist using these two materials together, the stone and the cushion. And I'm going to ask Quina to just read out some of those responses. Quina?
Hi, Kevin. Quina. We'll give just a few moments for people to respond in the chat.
Sure.
So So I see a few people, John and Victoria and Ada, says that there's this opposition between soft and hard, or contrast between soft and hard. Gabriella says they look comfortable and held. And I see Aaron says the pressure is now evident, because if it were just stones, we wouldn't see the weight and the pressure placed under them.
Very, very interesting.
We have a few more comments. Let me know when you want me to stop, but they're really wonderful. Jennifer says the stone is unyielding while the pillow is yielding. So similar idea of contrast or opposition, but in a slightly different interpretation. Esther says the cushions feel like hands. And Madison says
cradling them, right? So holding them with care and a little bit of care. That's a great comment. I think maybe we could stop with that, because I do want to talk about the artist, you know, his attraction to stone and that whole idea of using that material. And I love that thought of this cushion sort of cradling like hands. So I'm going to jump to another installation piece here from the exhibition. Here we have a photograph that also includes one of the artist's paintings in the background. And, you know, I forgot to mention as we began this that, you know, all of the artists that we're looking at today all have worked with across different kinds of mediums, but certainly we're just focused on one element of their work or one aspect of their work. But they all have quite a variety of mediums that they're working within. Kind of looking at this sculptural object here in the front. So here we have the artist kind of working with two elements, a large pre-selected stone and the steel plate, being a man-made object, but also one comes from natural materials, right? Made from elements that are pulled from the earth. And I just sort of love this idea about this, the stone maybe addressing this steel plate here. One element about this work that sort of intrigues me probably more than any of the other aspects is the fact that the steel plate is actually leaning against the wall, and thereby creating this sort of interesting void along the back edge here, this sort of space that's created. Lee talks about the idea of opening up the artwork to allow for breathing room, to allow for elements to come into the room. And we could think of that little space back there as to be maybe an exit or an entrance, and it could be one or the other. You know, we're not quite sure. His goal, Lee stated, was to make the not man-made speak. And so we can think about how he might be accomplishing that. I'm going to move forward here. So this is an artwork called Relatum Dissonance. And I think maybe we'll just view this work in private, in quiet for just a moment. And then when you feel comfortable, perhaps you can enter in the chat, maybe your thoughts about this particular work or what this might call to mind for you. But let's just take a moment to look. Again, we have similar elements. We were talking about stones and steel. And then, of course, that larger element being the space where it's installed. So I guess I would just ask you to take a look. And then if you feel comfortable, just enter your reaction into chat. Hi, Quina.
Hi, we had one response that says chopsticks.
Chopsticks, interesting, okay.
Interesting. It makes me think of responsibility. And then another thought, with connection, everything changes. Mm-hmm. And Aaron says attempting to balance.
life balance. Li is the philosopher, talking about all the different elements that kind of come into our life, like disappointment and all those things that are natural parts of our life. So maybe giving some expression to that. Okay.
I was taught by Barbara, who's mentioning the shadow, where the shadow of the stick is important.
So yes, I mean, an element that I just hadn't even thought to consider here today is also the idea of light and light creating a shadow, of course, in the space. So creating another dimension, perhaps, to the work that we're seeing here. That's a great comment. Thank you. I'm going to move forward just to look at another work here. This is a work by the artist also installed in our Guggenheim exhibition called Relatum Dialogue. I guess I'd like to just talk about, again, about these elements that the artist is using, the idea of space, of steel, of stones, and the viewer as the participant. Natural stones are really central to Leo Fon's work, and he's been using them from the very beginning. He visits quarries and spends considerable amount of time selecting the stones he uses. So each time that he creates a work, he's finding finding natural stones that relate specifically to his ideas at the time. He has a very funny story that he related about an exhibition early on that he was creating in Paris, and he searched and searched for the proper stones to use for this exhibition, and he could not find what he needed. And then right before the exhibition was to open, he found a whole series of stones. And he began removing them to take them to install in his exhibition. The stones, however, were coming out of a park in Paris. And so as the police got wind of this, they did an inquiry about it. But he was able to beg forgiveness and use the stones for his exhibition as long as he promised to return them properly after he finished. So I just like that idea that, we're going of him trying to look around and find what's on hand, the first thing that he could, the last thing actually that he finally found that was able to use for his, create his expression. When we think about this idea of stones, I mean, we might actually think about early artifacts from China or Egypt or even Central America as ancient, but Li reminds us here that we have natural materials that might be 500 to a million years old. And here is the artist literally carrying these objects forward and placing them right in front of us, right into a contemporary context, so that we can make a connection with that. So I'm going to move forward to an earlier work. So here we have a work by Li Ufan, created in 1969, and this is part of the work that was presented in an exhibition of the Monaha group. And this is we can see that the artist here, even early on, was using the same concepts of these stones, these large stones kind of placed throughout a space. And then he's added another element, and we can kind of see along the floor line here, there's this element that kind of moves along, joining these objects together. That element is actually a measuring tape that the artist has created. But instead of using something that's definitive, he's used this idea of rubber and chalk. So this is a rubber measuring tape and chalk marks along the way that can obviously change or move as the piece is stretched or elongated. I'm just curious about your thoughts, maybe about the idea of using a material like that. So this is rubber measuring tape, and how you might think that adds to Li's explorations of dimensions and space. So if you have comments, maybe feel free, you can enter those in the chat.
Can Can you repeat the question one more time?
Sure. Just so I was trying to get a reaction about this idea of the artist using the idea of him using a rubber and a chalk mark measuring tape to delineate space, and what the artist might be trying to say by those that particular choice of materials.
We had a question in the chat that asked, I'm wondering what instructions, if any, the artist provides for the installation.
Interesting. I believe that the artist, I mean, because he's still living, the artist is actually installing a lot of these works. I know that for our exhibition, you know, he was present there for several weeks installing those artworks. And I don't know for a fact that if, you know, I would imagine he, because he works so globally now that there's work installed all over the world, that he must leave some instructions on his intention. But again, it's really about the space for him. So I think without visiting the space, it might be difficult to give any kind of didactic requirements. So because they are all so flexible in terms of the installations.
We also had some responses to the choice of materiality. It's interesting to contrast, including the material of the floor. Mm-hmm. And then we had a funny phrase, the phrase, it's not nice to fool Mother Nature.
Well, that's great, that's great. Yeah, Lee, obviously the artist taking nature very seriously and you know, as part of our life. I'm going to go ahead and just move forward a little bit here, Quina, if that's okay. And here's a quote by the artist. It says, my art has become simpler and simpler as I limit my self-expression and place greater emphasis on the dynamics of empty resonant space. And so I think for our remainder of time with the artist, I'm just going to cycle through a few images of the artist's work, and we can maybe keep this thought in mind about limiting his self-expression and placing greater emphasis on the empty resonant space. So we're going to leave the artist with this installation as part of an installation that he did out on the property of Versailles in France. I'm going to leave you with a quote of his that, you know, nature is full of mystery and it's part of an endless continuity. So incorporating elements of air, sound, time, life, death, and dreams. All part of that endless continuity. So about the same time that artist Lee Ufan is working in Japan, we have, there he is again, I'm sorry, on a landscape, surveying his stones. So about the same time that Lee Ufan is beginning work in Japan, we have artist Bruce Nauman, who is actually working in California, also thinking about similar ways to, or thinking about other ways perhaps of just defining and delineating space. Likely, he often turned his focus to the viewer's interaction of space and objects, and he began this exploration with his own body by spending long periods of time in a studio directly facing the question of defining space. This time in his studio, these explorations often took on the appearance of multiple activities without being one in particular. part dance, part performance, part endurance test, part mathematical exercise, often sculptural. Nauman seemed to be working out his ideas internally while physically exploring space. He said from the beginning, he was trying to see if he could make art that was just there all at once. And so I'm gonna show you a piece by Bruce Nauman. This is a sculpture that's in the museum's collection, and it's entitled Performance Corridor. Performance Corridor consists of two 20-foot long walls that are 8 feet high and spaced about 20 inches apart from one another. And that incorporates the sculpture itself. This work was actually began life in Nauman's studio as a prop, as a space for him to create a performance. And these are some stills here from his video Walk with Contrapposto from 1968. And that is a video of the artist moving back and forth through this space, through this narrow channel, in a very exaggerated manner, similar to Renaissance sculpture of this very exaggerated contrapposto pose. This video lasts for about 60 minutes, an hour. So you can see why I maybe consider this as being part of an endurance test. But he never really considered the sculpture itself to be an art object. He was really thinking about it as a prop for his work. But once he had the idea that he might install it as a sculpture, he had to really consider what that meant. The artist was a little bit afraid of giving up control. He liked to be in charge of his own work. And so the idea of maybe leaving this open for the viewer to participate, for us to come in and participate in, was a little bit out of his comfort zone, a little out of his control. But once he decided to install it as a piece of artwork, he said that he was really intrigued by the idea that, you know, a visitor could enter this space. And the element of surprise that he felt was this dead end at the back, this corridor that would dead end against a wall. And so for him, that was actually maybe the catalyst that convinced himself to install it as an artwork. I'm going to go back to the work here in the museum's collection. And I'm going to just take a minute, maybe we can just take a minute to kind of look this work over kind of talk about it for just a moment. So, you know, in a more traditional sculptural sense, we can look at this as we can look at this work as maybe two independent forms, these two tall vertical walls, the modernist grid that's created by the structure that's kind of supporting that wallboard, which is just like a drywall and a manufacturing material, a construction material that we'd find in any home, and then these strong supports that are left exposed to kind of shore up that wall and make sure that it's stable. So if we think about these as two separate elements kind of coming together and interacting, we can maybe make some connection between the work of Li Ufan, two elements. I like to think of these two walls as maybe being magnetic, and instead of attracting, perhaps they're repelling one another just enough to create this space that we can enter. So if you can imagine that, you know, we're kind of walking into this room, we see this thing, it might be something that we find insignificant. We maybe wouldn't have even just thought of it as an art object, maybe that it was something that had been left behind. But everything here is intentional, and the artist creating this sort of rickety exterior and then this smooth kind of wallboard interior here. So I'd like us to just maybe take a moment to imagine what that might be like, to kind of scoot our way through that space and come back out the other side of that. I'm going to move forward a little bit to look at some other works. Now, once the artist had decided that he was going to do this as an artwork, he went on to create numerous installations of these works. But I want to just talk about how the artist is thinking about space. So he wrote that negative space for me is thinking about the underside and the backside of things. So thinking about exposing that back of that wall, both what's inside and what's outside determine our physical, our physiological, and our psychological responses. So, so I'm going to jump ahead here to a sculpture that the artist created, early work from began in 1965. And it's a concrete block. And the title of this work really tells us everything that we need to know about it. It's called A Cast of the Space Under My Chair. So the artist thinking very clearly about that idea of that negative space, the space that's left behind or the space that we don't consider. Just to kind of help you maybe explore a little bit how this might work. We can imagine here at the corners that this might be the leg of the chair kind of rising forward. And these other indentations here might be the supports that tie the legs together. And this upper part here, the supports that would wrap around and form the underside of the cushion or the seat portion, this being the underside of the seat portion here. And we can imagine perhaps, you know, there's a back to the chair that kind of rises up over around one of those corners. So the artist, again, just thinking about this idea of space and really trying to physically work that out, like what that means to him. But as I mentioned, once he had decided to create these installations, he went ahead and made a number of other installations with it, you know, some of them a little bit confusing or confounding. This one perhaps eliciting disappointment by the fact that we can't actually enter this corridor, that the space is too narrow to enter. In this particular work, he's actually included a mirror at the back end of the sculpture, and the artist would often do that. He'll incorporate other materials. So in this case, a mirror. So if we were to peer into this, we might see a kind of a dull spectral figure at the other end, sort of greeting us, perhaps. He would go on to create other works that might be a little bit confusing. In this case, we could see how we might be a little bit undecided about which path to take or which avenue that we should walk. The artist also including other materials. So in this case, you know, we talked just briefly about the idea of some light and a mirror. This one, he's using video cameras and video screens and projections and a video camera. So to kind of heighten our maybe our sense of anxiety about being watched in these sort of tight, narrow spaces. Let's move forward here. Here we have an example of the artist using colored light. The title of this work, very descriptive, Green Light Corridor from 1970, also part of our collection. Again, that sort of idea of using color as a way, or colored light as a way to maybe increase his anxiety or the mystery. I'm going to move forward in just a second. So although Nauman's work appears to be removed from Lee's connection with nature, their goals to provide work remain the same. Just jumping back here for a second to talk a little bit about Nauman's work. He wrote that my work comes out of being frustrated about the human condition and about how people refuse to understand other people and about how people can be cruel to each other. It's not that I think I can change that, but it's just a frustrating part of human history. So we have to think about the artist of trying to give voice to these sort of feelings that we trying to maybe illustrate to us this sort of anxiety that in our modern history. Li Ufan wrote about this type of work, including Nauman and other artists from that time period, how they present visual truths that diagnose the spiritual maladies of the 20th century. And so another work by, again, by Bruce Nauman. So while, again, they have similar goals to provide a transcendent space, we can see some obvious differences between the two artists. And we can maybe make our own associations about how we might feel about these being the contrast that these are created. You know, just one simple one that comes to mind, this idea of a closed space and maybe more of an open space and that relationship to nature. All right. So at the same time that those artists, that Li Ufan and Bruce Nauman are creating work in the mid-1960s in their various locations, we have the artist Koo Jong-ah, who is born in Seoul, Korea. And so I want to take a few moments to look at the work by this important artist from a generation moving forward. Here she is just standing in front of some natural elements, of course. So in 1967, Koo was born in Seoul. And this is a work from our collection. It's a work entitled Oslo. It consists of crushed aspirin on a wooden board and a blue light. And the dimensions on this work can be variable, again, depending on how it's installed. What we're seeing here is, if I can just maybe have you imagine with me what it might be like to enter this space. Here we have the artist using a larger space, and what it might be like to think about entering a darkened room. And maybe there, off in the distance, there's this sort of odd object that our eyes trying to adjust to the light maybe can't quite discern. We can call up to mind sort of the idea of waking up in the middle of the night, and things that might be familiar to us seem a little bit foreign and undefinable. So we can imagine kind of walking through this darkened space and working our way toward this sculpture placed in the back corner. We can wonder, you know, is that a mirage or is it actually something that's present in the space? Koo Jong-ah often use natural materials and small materials, ephemeral materials. And so we have this real distinction between her work and the work of, say, Bruce Nauman and Li Ufan, whose sculpture seems so solid and made of solid materials. Koo Jong-ah's work is much more fragile and maybe challenging us, our ideas a little bit more about our traditional representations of what the word sculpture. We can think about like wandering through this space and thinking about how that unexpected encounter, these ideas of intervention of space, and the viewer's relationship to the artwork and the surrounding atmosphere. So once again, kind of using all the similar ideas. I'm going to move forward here. Here's an installation, a gallery installation of a work. The artist also working with a variety of materials. This is just a small cardboard box that happened to be painted with phosphorescent material on paper mache, and then placed in a very unusual position in the gallery space. So we can imagine kind of encountering that along the way. This is a work of the artist using magnets to create an unexpected encounter in a gallery exhibition that she held in London. I'm going to just move forward a little bit. Another installation here, this idea of photography using an image of something that is actually very intangible. Smoke. So giving some solidity to an idea about something that is anything but solid. And then this idea of an unusual encounter again in space. So this is a work that the artist created with the organization Acute Art. And we can imagine kind of walking into a public park and seeing this floating ice block. It seems like a very kind of a normal, beautiful summer day. Here we have the block again floating in space. And it's somewhat confounding trying to wonder about how the artist was able to create these works. Well, she created it using augmented reality. So if we think about these dimensions of space, we have a photograph here that we're looking at, an image of a park setting with this floating cube, but what we're actually seeing is an augmented reality. The artist having using an app to provide that cube. And that's this art that we can travel with, art that we can carry with us to carry with us around space. And here we have just that idea that could be placed anywhere. Art can be seen anywhere. And here the artist has kind of created this multi-tiered exhibition of her work in a very public space. Guggenheim actually would go on to use that phosphorus material that we saw in an earlier work and create larger installations that deal with public spaces and three-dimensional usage. And what we have here is an outdoor skateboard park that the artist created in France. And she's created a number of these throughout around the world. There's in England and Brazil, this one in France. And we're going to move forward here a little bit. And here we have just a photographic image of an artist, of a visitor encountering this work. These often are open to the public. They're free to use. I think you might have a little bit of a wait to get into the space, but they're very popular, but certainly a way for us to interact directly with an artist's work and to feel that connection to working with the space that she's created for us. There's a little video I want to use here right now, and I'm going to go ahead and just let the artist speak a little bit in her own words. So if you'll bear with me, we'll get that launched.
My name is Guggenheim. I live and work everywhere. I didn't have the imagination of that shapes at the beginning, but I introduced heptagon, square, and triangle, all kind of decimal mathematics in pencil on the paper to introduce a square of the largest part of the circles, 6-0 in the end. It was interesting to make a circle, different sizes, angles, heights, and the positive circle, negative circle, and spiral, turner, into 2D, 3D, maybe 4D, imagine. And then all kind of reflection around you and around our human body, knowledge, and upside down reflection that say, sky is blue, grass is green. Instead of sky is blue, grass is green. The kind of things I really played and enjoyed. Emission of light and radiance are in nature and also in painting. And as a human being or like planets as well. So I was very interested in the moment of emission of light from the component as human being release their wisdom. I see myself emission of radiation from the painting on the skate park, as well as the planet in the sky.
So I just want to give a shout out to the Milano Triennial and to Guggenheim's workshop for allowing us to use that video. And then the credits, of course, for director and editor of that beautiful piece. Queenie is going to post that into chat for you so that you can view that as well. So I'm going to try to move forward here. So I'm coming full circle. I want to kind of bring us back around to this idea of David Smith again, and this idea of sculpture being a drawing in space. And I'm wondering if we can maybe make some connection here, thinking back to Ku's work, of course, that she is working with light again, once again, this idea of manipulating the space in the sense of using light. But here we have this embodiment of Smith's earlier notion of drawing in space. And we have another example of how we might be able to make that connection. So Ku Jian'a has taken that notion and she's turned it into a living, breathing experience. And so I'd like to end today. I thank you all for joining us. I'm going to end today with one quote from the artist Li Ufan. And he talks about how all things in the universe start from a point and relate to a point. One point calls up a new point and extends into a line. Everything is a scene of gathering and dispersal and of points and of lines. And so I want to thank you all for joining us today. We're just about out of time. And it's been my great pleasure to present these artists to you. I hope that if anything, I can just encourage you to try to see the art around us every day. If you get the opportunity in New York, to please visit us at the Guggenheim Museum in person. That we are open and would love to have you come if you can. So thank you so much.
So Kevin, we do have a few questions. And if those of you who can stay on want to submit questions using the Q&A, we can go over time a few minutes to answer those. But those of you that have to leave, again, I hope that you enjoyed this presentation. Kevin, what a beautiful walkthrough of artists. Who work in installations, such a difficult concept to understand in contemporary art, but also especially in the virtual space. So wonderful job. I also want to mention that if you've opted in for a Guggenheim email, you will receive a notification when all four sessions from this webinar series have been posted online. So hopefully you can watch the series over again. In the meantime, I'm going to move on to some questions that have been submitted. Kevin, if you don't mind answering a few. So we had an observation in the Q&A that noticed this connection between installation work and Sarah Zay's Boston MFA installation. And there was a question about how do you conserve these types of pieces and how do you reinstall these types of pieces in installation art?
Mm-hmm. So often the works exist in more in a conceptual nature. They're not necessarily, just as we talked about Li Ufan, those works are the concept of a natural material, and they're joined together at each time that they're installed. So I can think of if you can remember back to say the drawings by Bruce Nauman of the wall. So there's directions there in terms of a plan, in terms of how that installation should be presented. And I think often what happens is that those works are maybe not intended to be permanent, but are actually just exist in the world as a concept and as a plan. To be installed at various locations.
So. Thank you, Kevin. Two more questions about Bruce Nauman's work. One is, did he or Bruce Nauman make work himself, especially those works that are photographed or there's a video taken of the performance, were those all done by himself? And the second question about Bruce Nauman's work, would it have been possible as a viewer to enter into these tight, narrow spaces or these works such as the performance corridor?
Sure, they're intended to be entered if you can get through. So I think that was trying to illustrate that sometimes, you know, he makes it impossible for us to enter, but it is an invitation to walk through these spaces and to get a feel for what it might be like to kind of be in that compressed area, you know, feeling that kind of tightness. And I think that maybe goes back a little bit to the quote that I shared about, you know, the artist sort of talking about the difficulties that, you know, of the human condition. The more difficult aspects of the human condition. So they are definitely intended to be interactive and to be walked through and to explored. I'm sorry, Queen, just jumping back to the other part of that question.
Did Bruce Nauman work alone or...
Well, Bruce Nauman does create his own work. Because of the nature of his work, it's pretty. There are many elements involved often. So he's worked with filmmakers. He's worked with actors, where he's actually been director. Worked with an actor, or provided a script for actors to read out, and those are videos that actually you can find online. There's some videos posted online. And he currently has an exhibition open at the Tate Gallery in the Tate Modern in London. So if you happen to be traveling or out over in England, perhaps you have an opportunity to visit that exhibition as well. His work is collaborative, because he does employ other people to help him create these works. But he certainly has worked in printmaking, video. As I mentioned, there's a whole series of different mediums that the artist worked in. So
we have a follow-up question from Michael about the reinstallation of works. And Michael asks, how would you reinstall the ethereal work with the ground up aspirin?
Okay, so that may actually be have to rely on perhaps photographic evidence. Again, that work there are similar works that I've seen that you know are installed in a completely different way, but I think you would probably have some instructions in terms of what the work is intended to look like, and then maybe the installer of the artwork would have some leeway there in terms of how that was physically presented. But I think the goal there would be to come as close to the artist's intentions as possible. The benefit we have with all of these artists is that they're still currently living. So we can always reference that if they're available to help guide that process and make sure that the work is installed to their specification. I don't know if that answers the question.
So one last question, sir, this afternoon. Letty asks, has Nauman's walls ever fallen over as he performed, or is the precarity of the structure guarded as he performs within it? In other words, is physicalization as controlled as the forms he offers for inhabitation?
Well, that's an interesting question that I don't know the answer to. I would imagine that, because the intention is that the walls stand and that they provide some resistance to the viewer, or the participant as you're walking through, I would assume that there's probably some attention paid to that idea that there's a solidity there that you know, won't give way. I've experienced some of these works in the past. It's been many years since I've been into some of them, but my sense of it is that they always felt very secure and solid. But I don't know if there have ever been any kind of disruptions in a presentation like that. So.
Thank you so much, Kevin. So since we're a few minutes over time, I think it's time for us to say goodbye. I'm putting an email in the chat. If you have any follow-up questions, we're happy to answer one-on-one as well. And thank you all for your support today of the Guggenheim through participating in this webinar series.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.